Hello and welcome to Money Control's Personal Finance Podcast, brought to you by Kuvera.in, India's first completely free mutual fund investing platform. You're listening to Lisa Pallavi Barwora, and joining me for this episode is Mrinal Singh from ICICI Prudential Mutual Fund. Mrinal is the Deputy CIO for Equity Investments and currently manages roughly 20,000 crores of assets. Mrinal, welcome to Simply Save.
Thank you. Thanks, Lisa. Good to be here.
So there is a lot happening in your domain of equity stocks and markets these days. As a fund manager, do you think it's a difficult period for you, would you say?
So, markets are always challenging. That's the interesting part of it also.
Okay.
It is no different this time. There are always some things which are bothering the market. There are some things which are keeping the market happy. And that creates a volatility, and most money managers are comfortable with volatility and they know how to deal with it in the variety of styles that they practice.
Okay. So today's discussion is around your conviction of stock picking and portfolio construction that a fund manager brings to table. And the Indian mutual fund industry is still an active fund manager's kind of feeding ground despite the recent popularity of index funds or passive funds. So let's begin by talking about the current market. So there was a lot of correction happening, then we had a sudden surge, but earnings uncertainty continues. Fund managers like yourselves often work with unique models of financial and fundamental parameters that you apply to companies. So do you find that you have to abandon some of these assumptions in cycles like what we are seeing now?
So I've seen through cycles, that based on the phase of the cycle in the market, few concepts or things find favor. But as you evolve as a money manager or a fund manager, there is typically what I call an investing jacket that people, are comfortable with. They wear that, they practice that,
right,
and they constantly try to evolve or improvise upon it. Investing, in my view, is very classical, very simple, but not easy.
Okay.
So that's an important way how I would articulate. Once you know, so if I have to say what is investing, investing is buying cheap and selling high or selling expensive. But then it's so easy to say,
yeah,
far more difficult to practice. In the meanwhile, the markets can be rational longer. As they say, it's a very famous saying in Indian investing circles, markets can remain irrational longer than you can remain solvent.
Yeah.
So you have to be relevant, you have to do the right things. And most people, if you ask, who are associated with investing would know what is the right thing. What would be the difficult part is how many of them can actually practice that. Because comes with it a lot of, at times you have to be contrarian, at times you have to be ahead of the street, at times you have to be against the street. And there are a lot of questions that you might need to answer. It is important to understand that investing requires bouts of underperformances, and obviously there are bouts of overperformance or outperformances. The whole idea why people propagate idea of being invested for long term is to be able to benefit from the overall scheme of things from an investing style. So every investing style would encompass a zone where it excels and another zone where it struggles.
Okay.
So most people who wouldn't have a long-term orientation or lack of understanding of that investing style might tend to, give up at an absolute wrong time and get drifted into something which is an absolute wrong time again to make an entry into, which is where financial intermediaries have an important role to play.
Okay.
Well, having said that, there is very often that temptation, that doubt, at least in the early money manager's mind, this is what I thought works and this doesn't seem to be working anymore.
Yeah, because volatility can create that kind of nervousness,
Or illusion, I might say, very often you would see, as you mentioned, earnings haven't come across.
Yeah.
And the stocks keep rallying and you tend to feel, okay, the world thinks that this is going to do well going ahead. Will everything work? So, the market is a very smart set of people, we have to be very well versed about it. So acting in a manner where you think you will put down on the market is completely wrong.
Right.
But market does offer those small opportunities or windows of mispricing.
Okay.
The another characteristic that market always exhibits is it has a tendency of overreacting on both sides. It tends to overestimate a good input.
Right.
It tends to also overestimate at times a bad input. Now this is the business we as money managers are in. So we tend to, you know, through our acumen, judgment, analysis or forecasting or variety of financial fundamental things, try to make sense of, okay, fine, this is good, but this is only good till this level. Beyond this, maybe it doesn't make.
So you try to use volatility to your advantage without, you know, letting go of your basic conviction around a stock or, you know, what you're investing in.
Along with that, at times for external risks, particularly, market displays humongous volatility.
Yes.
And there are zones of, you know, very attractive broad prices. For example, last time we saw that was in 2013 and post the taper tantrum.
Yeah.
And with hindsight, you might feel like, you know, that end of 2017 looked like the best times to get rid of mid and small cap for the time being.
Yes.
So these things happen, you know, and it should not be confused with the concept of trading. Investing is not trading. This is just the way. So the index might give you an illusion that it has moved a percent or two up and down, but in the meanwhile there are stocks which have far more movement. Which is where you keep an eye, and sometimes things fall into a zone where you might choose to make an investment and continue to hold.
So that's how you deal with the market movement broadly. But as we were talking earlier, now every fund also has a benchmark index against which returns are compared. Now the benchmark defines clearly what you cannot include in the portfolio, because kind of it sets the universe where you can pick from. But what role does it play in actually determining the allocations or weights or what you do buy?
It's an excellent question, and it's a subject which is still being discussed, particularly by the active industry, because industry as a whole has seen more or less an onslaught from the index funds. So the good part is that there is an index to every fund.
Yes.
And the intent is to do better than the index, particularly for active money managers, to justify the fees that they charge, whatever that quantum of fees is, and do better than that.
That's the whole idea. No?
Yes. Now, well, theoretically, unless the SID of the fund prohibits you to deviate, it is not something that the index clearly defines is that all you can do.
Okay.
For example, you know, there might be a fund which might have only a large cap index or a mid cap index or a small cap index or a broader index, let's say like a BSE 500 or an NSE 500. And they have various sectors in it and they have various stocks in it. But then it does not mean that you cannot deviate from that. In fact, if you're a true active money manager, the deviation would be higher. So one of the things institutional clients typically look for when they look at active managers, and this is something that I've seen out of interactions, they tend to look at the deviation. But it's an incomplete statement to say that, okay, you deviate more and it's fine. No, the important part is the deviation can be higher or medium or whatever is the permissible limit as per the risk framework of the fund or the fund house or anything, which has to be predefined and to be tracked on a real-time basis. You have to also go right.
Yeah, but that you'll only know in hindsight, no?
Now that's the beauty of this business. Yeah. So whenever you're investing, you're talking about what should do well in the future.
Right.
And now this is where I'll take a pun at the index funds. Index funds is about what has done well in the past.
Okay, yes.
Interestingly, I am of a belief, not because I belong to that zone in terms of my professional practice, but also of a belief that active is going to stay and it's going to flourish.
Mm-hmm.
Practicing active in a true way would be an important aspect. It will never be subjugated by replicating the index, the wisdom and judgment of getting the future right.
Okay.
And that's not speculation, that's more to do with, you know, what is the risk reward, what do you think could translate. It also is important to understand index is a mathematical output of a calculation. At times it is free float, at times, you know, there are other conditions, but then it does put restrictions.
Yes.
It is also fully infested with what has done well in the past. So deviation, so for active money managers in particular, index could be a guiding principle. It should be relevant to your style of investing rather than being a restrictive form of investing.
Understood.
So if you claim to be a large cap fund, it makes sense that you have a large cap index. If you claim to be a multi-cap fund, it makes sense to be a multi-cap index or a broader index like a BSE 500 or an NSE 500. Yeah. And if you're a mid-cap fund, it makes no sense if you create a large-cap index for it. So you have to have a mid-cap.
It's a guiding path. But what you're saying is that deviations help in generating that excess return, which what active managers contribute to the scheme. But is there a limit then to how much you can deviate? Because if you deviate too much, then it can become, you know, a large cap scheme can become, you know, more inclined towards mid cap. So does that get defined in the SID like you were talking about? Or is that something which again is a prerogative of the active fund manager?
So well, it gets defined at 2-3 layers. The SID itself will have a restriction as well as definition of what tolerance it can have.
Okay.
So let's say if there is a multi-cap product or fund, it might say that, okay, in large cap, you could be, you know, 40-60%, and you could be in mid cap, let's say 20-40%,
okay,
and remaining could be
so
a
range can be defined.
So, yeah, so that's one. So if the SID clearly defines, so that's the guiding principle, that's the Bible for that.
Yes.
If above that, there can still be restrictions that can be put across, or let's say controlling conditions that can be put across in the judgment of the investment house itself,
okay,
which might not be part of SID but could be as well part of the general understanding of the risk framework. For example, what kind of sectoral division? So you might be allowed to have large caps, let's say 40-60%, I'm just using it
yes,
as an example,
yes,
but then the sectoral division could still be, has to be maintained within X,
okay.
Or a stock level allocation should be Y, or other kind. So it is all, the whole intent is to actually control the risk,
right,
rather than restrict.
Okay.
So it's very important because inadvertently a large cap product is lesser riskier than a mid cap product, let's say.
Yes.
So its risk profile should reflect that sequence. It should not happen that the multi cap product comes across as more riskier than a mid cap product. Because the allocations of customers have accordingly been matched. So that's the whole idea. I would say that index is very important. It is something that has to be bettered, but it's not a restrictive thing around.
Great. So now let's talk a little bit about market trends. Now, about maybe 2 years, 1.5 years ago, many equity mutual fund portfolios across large cap, multi cap, even your kind of value schemes, they had one stock, a private banking stock, which was, you know, among the top holdings, if not the top, then the top five. Majority of equity schemes had this. So what I wanted to understand is how much do market trends, now obviously there was a reason for that, but how much do market trends actually dictate stock selection, and do you embrace or avoid trends consciously in certain market cycles?
If you notice in the, at least the index, let's say the NSE 50, Nifty 50 or the Nifty 100, banking is a very large
yes,
weight, anything from 35% to 40%.
One-third,
yeah, so
roughly.
35 to 40 in that range, based upon which index you look at. Now, which also means that it very often becomes the largest sector allocation for most funds. So even if you are underweight, let's say most people would be typically in the range of mid 20s or 30, which still is an underweight compared to the index, but then it still is the largest weight in absolute terms. And you're absolutely right when you notice that, you know, most funds, irrespective of the category that
yes,
we have, seemingly seem to possess amongst the top five holdings at least two or three which are belonging to this sector and inadvertently become, you know, a large percentage of the portfolio. Having said that, there are still products or funds you will see that do not have something like that. For example, you know, particularly in the context of fund that I manage, in case of Discovery, you will see banking is not the largest weight for us.
Okay.
And that is what I mean when I say, you know, that active money managers could tend to deviate. So the largest sector for the entire industry, for the entire index, could be banking and financials, but it is not the largest allocation for us in that product.
Right.
Having said that, that product contours and SID allows us to do that.
Okay.
There are a host of products that would have restrictions on what kind of deviation you can take.
Yeah.
And they work within those frameworks. So it's absolutely right when I see, you know, people have within that framework chosen what they think is the best to
yes,
put monies into.
Yeah.
which might come across as a market trend.
It surely did at that time. I haven't checked it up recently, but it did, yes.
It does come across as a market trend. I fully acknowledge that. But then there would be, if you just flip a few more pages and portfolios, there would be products like I mentioned in case of discovery and a few more in the industry, which are smaller in numbers. I don't deny that, maybe 10% at max, which are clearly doing what I would call, you know, very classical investing in terms of, you know, still choosing what they think is right rather than being guided by the weights in the index. But then it's important to understand that these few products are allowed by their SIDs and frameworks to, you know, to do that.
So it's really the individual scheme and the fund manager style and what the scheme SID dictates that finally combines into that portfolio against the market trend. Okay, Mrinal, so one last thing that I wanted to check with you is on this, you know, the structure of a mutual fund scheme. It's open-ended, which means that you receive money on the same day money is going out. This constant cash in and cash out from the fund, does that require that a portion of your AUM is allocated flexibly as opposed to matched with your style of investing?
So again, a very good question, Lisa. This is something in 2007-8, we learned this the hard way.
Okay, everybody learned a lot of lessons in that period. I always hear this.
So what I particularly am mentioning to is in quite a lot of our products and funds, we were geared up for 2008. So we dealt with the market pretty well.
Okay.
And then Satyam happened. Markets were already down almost 45% calendar year by then, and then we started seeing redemption, and the redemption continued to the extent that our existing holdings we had to sell to service our customers withdrawing money. And that's a very painful experience in the sense you feel that, you know, your customers have been around and now that it is working, some of them are withdrawing and it is hurting the others who continue to have faith in the in equities and the investing style that we have pursued. At least people who've seen through cycles keep an eye on the liquidity of the portfolio. So since then, however bullish we might get into the illiquid part of the zone of the market, let's say in last 2013, mid and small cap was extremely attractive. We capped our exposure to the illiquid part of the market to, let's say, 80% or 85% or something. So we wanted to ensure that if there is any kind of money is getting withdrawn for whatever needs that customer might have and it comes across to us as redemption, it should not destroy or cause damage to the construction of the portfolio, which is geared up for the upcoming times. So it's relevant. It's always on the back of any money manager's mind who's seen through cycles. You also see phases wherein, you know, money comes. So these are more relevant, Lisa, in when the funds are very small.
Okay.
So out of my experience, I'll tell you, when the funds are small, they are doing well. At times, you get 2% of the AUM in a day.
Yes, it happens. To deploy that money is also, it's a difficult task.
Yeah, so the whole point is, it again falls back to the whole idea of, you know, through a cycle.
Okay.
It's very important that, you know, people have seen both redemption as well as subscription, inflows, outflow cycle, and they will act in a very judicious way. And liquidity is an important aspect. So you might theoretically have a situation where you are for last 3 days getting a percentage or two of the AUM. It's possible, it happens.
Yes.
But then if you're invested, let's say 98%, you can choose to not act for 2-3 days and it goes to 95, it's all right. It never pays well to do desperate investing.
Okay.
So that's not a good thing. I tend to ensure a situation that we don't end up in a situation where we will have to desperately buy something where ourselves we are not fully convinced about it. That's not good. So we do keep both in cases of inflows and outflows expectation. We do keep those buffers that we should have some leeway in terms of 2-4 days or 5 trading sessions. And then in the meanwhile, what's the best option available will do. A lot of people practice it in a way that they replicate the portfolio itself. So for every 10 rupees that come, they just split it the way the portfolio is.
Right.
I generally don't tend to do that. I tend to buy something. Incremental money needs incremental ideas or incremental. So there might be an existing name which we continue to like. We might put monies there. The interesting aspect is not that. The interesting aspect is you might get money or get redemptions at an absolutely wrong time.
Okay. When you don't want money, you get money, and you know.
So you might get too much money in mid caps when you think the mid caps are not so cheap. Now that becomes a tricky part. Industry in the past has obviously done closure of funds. We keep it open only for SIPs. Those kind of things we've done. It's still an option, not very abundantly practiced, but then SIPs are kept open, or you restrict the quantum of absolute monies that can come.
Yeah, that happens.
There is also an option of, if you think you are not getting any great ideas, option of paying back in terms of dividends. You might as well do that. Nobody stops you from giving back, but provided you have to book profits. You can't keep money then keep giving back. That's not the thing. That's not allowed either. But if you think markets don't look that great, you can give back as dividend. You can maybe put restrictions on lump sums if that is the case. And in the bottom, anyway, any amount of money is welcome. If money goes, there is liquidity that has to be maintained. But over the last 10-12 years in particular, I've seen mindset of customers, particularly retail customers, evolving.
That's
12 years ago, we used to, most discussions used to be 1 year returns and things like those. Now people talk about 3 year, 5 year returns and maybe ahead. So market is evolving. Customers are more understanding of what it takes to be there. So we have more stable money. Industry has also very wisely acted on pushing SIPs. SIPs is the best form of investment that can be done by retail, as well as the best form of monies that can come to a fund, because we can also plan like that. So I know, okay, this is the SIP book that we run monthly, so we know this kind of money's come, accordingly we can plan. Yeah, so it's far more stable. It's more significantly relevant for funds which are new, haven't seen a cycle, and are small.
Great. Just one last thing for investors who are listening to the podcast, what in your mind is the minimum? I wouldn't say maximum, because you know there's a whole goals overplay on that, but what is the minimum time to be invested in a equity fund to see through like an entire cycle of corporate profitability, etc., which can add to returns for them?
Most people tend to put a timeline of sometimes people say 3 years, sometimes people say 5 years.
Yes.
But you've articulated in a right way. The whole idea is not number of years, the whole idea is a cycle.
Yes.
So if I take the liberty of looking at it from today's prism, I would say cycle encompasses three zones in particular: a flat zone, an upward trajectory, and a downward trajectory. So if you are evaluating funds to deploy your monies to, ideally, I think you should be able to see the stability of the strategy as well as performance from 2006 and ahead. Because a cycle in the context of today means
it has lasted longer, perhaps.
Yes. Wherein we thought, given the information technology, cycles would compress.
Yes.
But a cycle, I would say, 2006 all the way till 8-9, flattish market, up again. I would say if a strategy has been stable, has done well in the last 12-13 years, it's a good one.
Great.
And that's a great filter. And you will be surprised when you put funds across through that filter. The number of eligible products will reduce substantially.
It's worth looking into. So thank you, Mrinal. For fund managers, it seems there's no easy way out. I think what I hear Mrinal saying is that one has to be open and flexible, but within limits of conviction. Without convictions, investors get nothing unique from an active fund manager. Thank you, listeners, for staying tuned in to this episode. Remember, mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme documents carefully before investing. Do your homework. And if you have any queries, you can write into mcpodcast@nw18.com. That's mcpodcast@nw18.com. For more news, views, and updates, stay logged on to moneycontrol.com. Thank you, Mrinal.
Thanks. It was a pleasure.